Okay, Slava needs no further introduction.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And we'll give his second lecture.
Okay, yes. I was asked to repeat in a different way what I said during the last 10 minutes, but okay, by a laser. But let me start with good anecdote. It's in fact a real story about Zeldovich, which has something to do with theoretical physics, because Landau was always telling that theoretical physicists should take care just about order of magnitude. And when Landau was visiting once when Zeldovich perhaps still was in Leningrad, now St. Petersburg, and perhaps in future Putinburg, yeah, I do not know. Yeah. Then Zeldovich took Landau to the financial office, and Landau was counting every ruble. And then Zeldovich told him, come on, you told us that real theoretical physicists should take care only about order of magnitude. Then Landau looked at him and told that, don't forget that money always come in exponent. Therefore, when the things will be coming in exponent, I will take care. But otherwise, I will be taking care just about order of magnitude. And for many practical purposes, okay, when I write derivative, for instance, of scale factor, as a real physicist, I can always write like this one, A divided by T. For the functions which are not exponential, it's always good for theoretical physicists. So yesterday I derived this time interval, and then actually universe has homogeneous two things which characterizes evolution, namely energy density and scale factor, and pressure normally comes from microphysics, and with good approximation you can write it as pressure is proportional to energy density with some constant here, which people call the equation of state, which is 0, 1/3, or approximately minus 1. Then we got two equations for this thing. This is so-called first Friedman equation, where curvature enters 8pg over 3 epsilon, and second equation was epsilon dot is equal minus 3 a dot over a, epsilon plus p. Then, if you substitute here this p, then integrate this equation, you will get immediately that energy density is proportional 1 divided by a in power 3, 1 plus w. You take this thing, substitute here, and then you observe that if w is larger than minus 1/3, then 1 over a squared, 1 over a cube, 1 plus w, is growing much faster than 1 over a squared when a goes to 0. Therefore, it means that at early moment of time, you can neglect this term in the case when equation of state satisfies this condition, from which it follows that second time derivative is negative, and you have decelerated expansion, but k equals 0 case is a past attractor. And then when you neglect this thing, when you write it 1 over t squared, then you are getting immediately that in past scale factor is proportional to t in power alpha, where alpha is equal to divided by 3, 1 plus w. And for this case, this alpha is smaller than 1. This is the reason why second derivative is negative. It's decelerated expansion. Now, if you take case when W is smaller than minus 1/3, then A2 dot becomes positive, gravity is repulsive force in some sense. And in this case, you understand that epsilon goes like 1 over A in some power which is smaller than 2. Therefore, when A goes to infinity, this term can be neglected. Therefore, K equals 0 is a future attractor in accelerating universe. And therefore, you are getting flat universe. There is other explanation why in accelerated universe you are getting flat universe, irrespective of the initial condition after some time. Because as I said yesterday, omega, which determine u, the curvature of the space, okay, can be written down like this one. And if universe is flat, then this cosmological parameter is equal 1. If universe is open, then it's smaller than 1. When it's closed, then it's larger than 1. You can verify very easily that the same thing can be rewritten in a different form. Take some cloud of matter in our universe, which undergoes this Hubble expansion, then calculate its self-interaction energy, so-called, which is negative, gravitational energy of self-interaction, calculate its kinetic energy of the Hubble expansion, and then you will find that omega is E potential energy, which is negative, therefore you take this thing, divided by E kinetic. Now, you can start at the beginning at any ratio. For instance, let's take this ratio 3. So, potential energy is 3 times large. Then when you have the stage of accelerated expansion, only in this case, okay, this kinetic energy is growing. You see, because you have acceleration. Then to preserve total energy, which is sum of potential and kinetic, potential is negative, this thing, absolute magnitude, also should grow. And then, if, for instance, this thing was at the beginning 1, this thing was 3, then you add 10-10 factor, which corresponds to the increase of potential and kinetic energy, but one energy is negative, the other is positive, therefore total is conserved. And then you understand that this thing goes to 1. This is the other explanation why, as a result of the accelerated expansion, you are getting all this flat universe. You just should not restrict yourself in the duration of this stage. If you want to get, for instance, open universe, as people want it when they search, some people, okay, that universe is really open, you have fine-tuned the duration of the stage of accelerated expansion. But normally, at this case, you were not solving so-called homogeneity isotropy problems. Therefore, people in the 90s invented this kind of perverse scenario with two accelerated stages. One was responsible for making universe flat. Then you had tunneling. Then, as a result, you were getting what was called Kalman-Deluce instanton, where hypersurfaces of constant time were synchronized by the wall, and which corresponded to open universe, and then you needed to fine-tune the duration of second stage if you wanted to get omega 0.3. Of course, it's rubbish, and was clear from the very beginning that it's rubbish, but, you know, you know that we have many opinions, and people who are fathers of perhaps not the kid who is genius, nevertheless think still that the kid is genius, as you know. Most of the parents behave like this one, in physics also, okay? Some people who created some theory, which can be even ugly, they can still that it's still nice. You see, but let's don't discuss it. Now, okay? Then you understand that our life, if you would assume this stage of accelerated expansion would simplify a lot because we can save a lot of chalk just keeping this term in the solutions. But because it's general relativity also partially in cosmology course, just to introduce you some kind of useful notion from general relativity, because I'm going to speak about the notion of horizon and a little bit about conformal diagram, let me consider two exact solutions of this equation with k equal plus one, okay, for the universe which is filled by cold matter and radiation. In this case, this equation can be solved very easily if instead of physical time, I introduce so-called conformal time. You will see in a minute why it's called conformal, because it's defined like this one, a squared d eta squared is equal dt squared. But finally, I want to take this scale factor outside of the metric interval altogether. This is the reason why it's called conformal time. Then if I will use this time variable in this equation, okay, substitute here instead of derivative with respect to t, derivative with respect to eta, which I denote by prime, then differentiate this equation once, use this equation, then these two equations will be reduced to the equation like this one, a2 prime plus ka is equal 8p, or maybe 40, wait a minute, 8pg, no, 4p, 8pg over 3, epsilon minus 3p, a cube. Now it starts to look really nice. Why? Because if I have ultra-relativistic equation of state pressure is equal epsilon over 3, then this term drop out. And I have equation for harmonic oscillator, which in the case of k equal plus 1, has solution a is equal am sine eta. And you understand that eta here is changing from 0 to pi. And you have universe which is expanding and then contracting after reaching maximal radius. For the case of closed universe. Now, how this space can be drawn if I forget about angular path? Eta in this case is changing in this finite interval, and chi for the case k equal plus 1 also is changing in the same interval. Therefore, the whole space can be represented by square, here really square, with the sides pi and pi. And this is called conformal diagram of the positive curvature universe filled by radiation. Now, if I will take case pressure is equal to zero, then epsilon goes like 1 over a cube, so epsilon a cube is constant. I am getting again harmonic oscillator equation, but with constant force in the right-hand side, and solution of the equations in this case look, where is?
Left.
This one, okay, good. Then solution in this case look like a, p equals 0, k equals plus 1, am divided by 2, 1 minus cosine eta. You see where eta is changing now in the interval from 0 to 2 pi. This is the difference from the previous case, and it will be quite important when we will be studying the propagation of light, because in the case of closed universe filled by dust, conformal diagram in this dimension, direction, has the size which is twice larger, okay, than in this direction. Okay, so these are two cases which are very representative where you can draw conformal diagram immediately. Yeah, with infinite spaces is more or less the same story, but let's forget about it for a minute. And now there is one more interesting case. The way I can get exact solution is the case of so-called de Sitter, when pressure is equal to minus energy density. In this case, what I am getting? In this case, it's much better to work again with equation in terms of the derivative with respect to time, because it looks like this one, minus 4pg over 3 epsilon plus 3p a. Now, when pressure is equal minus energy density, let's call it vacuum, you understand that this thing is constant. This follows from the equation epsilon dot is proportional to epsilon plus p. Then this whole thing becomes equal minus 2 epsilon plus you are getting, because two minuses, as you know, when you multiply them, give plus. Now, equation becomes again very simple, like equation for harmonic oscillator, okay, but with negative sign here, with negative frequency squared, where h lambda is equal 8pg squared over 3 epsilon v, which is constant. And then solution, generic solution of this equation is A equals C1, constant of integration exponent, HT, H lambda T, plus C2 exponent minus HT. Of course, these two constants of integration are not completely arbitrary in this case. Why? Because I forgot to use constraint equation. If now I will take this A dot equation, substitute it there, then I am getting immediately relation for C1, C2. It will be like 4H lambda squared C1, C2 is equal K, where K is a special curvature. But the most amazing thing is that here, for the given energy density, I'm getting three solutions. Okay, because if I will use this condition and also use the freedom and the choice of the beginning of time, then three solutions which will follow from here will be A is equal 1 over H lambda. Here, cosine hyperbolic HT, sum of two exponent, then exponent HT for the expanding universe, and sine hyperbolic HT. You could ask question, or you shouldn't ask question, how for the same epsilon I got three different curvatures. The answer to this thing is very simple, because you understand that when epsilon is not changing, space time has extra symmetry. Its time translation invariant, the Sitter group is as rich as Poincaré group. So it has 10 parameters. Just 4 translations are replaced by extra 4 rotations, roughly speaking. And therefore, all these three solutions is description of the same physical situation in three different coordinate systems. You could ask question, which of these three coordinate systems covers the manifold completely? And the answer is a little bit unusual, because you think that if space is infinite, then, okay, coverage should be more complete. But in fact, here the complete coverage is done by k equal plus 1 coordinate system. And now, if you will go from physical time again to so-called conformal time, then you will find that in this case of cosine hyperbolic scale factor in terms of conformal time becomes minus 1 over h lambda sine eta, minus I took here for convenience, and eta is changing from minus pi over, from minus pi to zero. And then scale factor, how it's evolving? It was infinite, it's contracting, reaches the minimal value and starts to expand. But this case also corresponds to high from zero to pi. Therefore, if you would ask about conformal diagram of the sitter, what you would find here? You would find that it's the same square precisely like in the case p is equal epsilon over 3. With only difference, in case p equal epsilon over 3, you know that on these boundaries, curvature becomes infinite. Therefore, to stress this fact, people drawing singularities here. Here, in case of the sitters, there are no singularities whatsoever, but nevertheless, causal structure of the sitter is precisely the same as the causal structure of the universe, closed universe, filled by the radiation, with exception of these two boundaries. One more interesting thing is that if you would take this diagram and would ask question, which part of these manifolds are covered by flat coordinate system and by open coordinate systems, and you will find that flat coordinates are covering only this upper part of the diagram. And open hyperbolic coordinates are covering, okay, only this little corner. But the more essential thing that close to this boundary, all evolution law are the same, because you know that cosine, hyperbolic exponent, and sine are all going to the exponent. Therefore, all three coordinate coverages are not practically distinguishing near this upper boundary. And on conformal diagram, the most relevant part of the space is shrinked to very small part. It's precisely like on black hole diagram. Infinite space is in little corner of the diagram. This is the property of conformal diagram, that they confuse all the scales. Therefore, you have to think about it before. Yeah? And normally people are considering, of course, especially those who love mathematical physics, okay, in distinction from Landau, I mean with theorems, they want to have complete coverage of the sitter space, in spite of the fact that eternal the sitter space for physics is as useless as no the sitter space at all. In fact, actually, everything what is relevant for the nature is this little piece. Because this piece of the diagram describes the same de sitter, but okay, in the adapted coordinate, it would correspond actually to the data when you take all your points and send them together, and then anti-gravity stops this kind of contraction. It's clear that it's extremely unstable situation. Therefore, for instance, one of the remarks for the people who knows what is the point, if you would take de sitter invariant state for the massive scalar field, then there is one single so-called Bunch Davis, which is the sitter invariant vacuum. And if you will spoil this vacuum a little bit near this border, then you get complete instability with what I believe my some friends, whom I will not name, are puzzled so much, but in fact, is just nothing more than some kind of non-realistic situation. Because, you know, when you formulate initial conditions in this particular case, you have also to formulate this initial condition when you will introduce certain frame, and this initial condition, which gives you absolute instability, ну, they are not extremely probable, as I would say. But nevertheless, if you start at t goes to minus infinity, everything will be ruined if you spoil a little bit your Bunch Davis vacuum, for instance, introducing self-interaction. But okay, this was for the people, yes, who are mostly, who knows what I'm talking about. If you don't know them, forget it. So now, next question is about light propagation, because all information about universe we are getting with the help of light. And at a certain point, I was shocked when Ginsburg once said that he was told by some astronomer that all the energy which all telescopes which delivered us so much information got in the course of 100 years is perhaps comparable or less than energy which I need to take this block note and then move 1 meter away. But nevertheless, you understand that information and energy are sometimes not the same thing, okay? So you need, in fact, if you have enough time, then you need infinitely small amount of energy to transfer any amount of information. But for that, you have to have enough time, as you know. Now, so how light is propagating? Because, fortunately or unfortunately, we cannot travel to the other galaxy. We can put ourselves in the center of coordinate system. And everything what we need to learn when we are considering propagation of light is the propagation of so-called radial geodesics. So let me introduce this conformal time, and then I can rewrite metric in the following form. A squared eta, d eta squared minus d chi squared minus, here the radial path. So you see, instead of dt, I introduce a d eta. Here, now, I am interested in function chi as a function of conformal time. How to solve equation for geodesic? In this case, you don't need to write it. You have to use the first integral of the geodesic equation, which for light looked like this equals zero. And then you can skip this conformal factor, and then you immediately get that chi as a function of eta is plus minus eta plus constant of integration. So if I will take chi eta coordinate, then light is always propagating in this coordinate at the angle 45 degrees. If I put myself here, then this is incoming light, this is the light which I am sending. Next notion, after I introduce this conformal time, is the notion of horizons in our universe. And there are two horizons. One is called particle horizon, and the other is called event horizon. People sometimes introduce also Hubble radius, but it's auxiliary notion in addition to causality. Yeah, so what are these horizons? Horizon, particle horizon. Okay, so let me leave conformal diagram. One I removed already. Okay, I can draw it. Two boxes I can draw once more. Okay, what does it mean, particle horizon? Particle horizon characterizes the size of causally connected region, and its existence is related with the fact that in past our universe had the beginning, and it existed only finite time. If you forget about curved space, you know that in the universe, which existed only time t, light can propagate at the maximal distance ct, and this is the size of causally connected region. Now, how these things can be formalized when we consider curved spacetime? We know the law of propagation, and we know that universe in past had the beginning at the moment of conformal time, eta is equal eta e. Therefore, it's clear that the maximal commoving distance which light can propagate till the moment of time eta is equal to eta minus eta initial. And this is the size of causally connected region, yeah, in this commoving coordinate. If you want to recalculate everything in centimeters, what you do? You write this expression as integral over dt over a, put here t initial, t final, but it's still not centimeter, you have to multiply by scale factor. because we measure ds. And the only thing which by which you can multiply the whole thing here is scale factor at the last moment of time, because at the beginning it's equal to zero. Otherwise, you will get nothing. It's also convention of definition, yeah? Here. Okay, so t initial to t final dt over a. And this is so-called physical size of this event horizon. But before I go to this thing, let's look at the conformal diagram. We have conformal diagram, for instance, for the universe, which is filled by pressure equals zero. And conformal diagram for the universe, which is filled pressure equal epsilon over 3, and also the sitter, which are the same if you forget about singularities. Now, where here is particle horizon? You understand that in this universe, closed universe, if you use this formula and set ni equal to zero, particle horizon is going like this one. So particle horizon in the universe with pressure equal zero, k equal plus one, exists till the moment when universe will reach maximal radius of expansion. But at this moment of time, all points in the universe which exist, you will see, and particle horizon doesn't exist anymore. Before, it was there. Here is the maximal radius of expansion. What is the difference with this case? Here you see, shape is different. Particle horizon exists all the time in the sitter or in radiation-dominated universe. And, for instance, in radiation-dominated universe, you see all the point only at the moment when universe will recollapse, but not before. So, essential thing, in this case, light has chance to travel twice through the whole space. Here, it has chance to travel only once through the whole space. Now, what is the physical size of this particle horizon? First of all, let's consider the case when A is proportional to T in power alpha with alpha smaller than 1. Alpha smaller than 1 means decelerated universe. Then, look at this formula. If alpha is smaller than 1, then the main contribution to the integral will come from the upper bound. Then, what will be the estimate of this integral? It will be t. So you understand that in a natural way, I got this generalization which I had. You can substitute 2/3, and you get 3ct, etc., but it doesn't mean that light propagating with the speed, 3 speeds of light. As you know, it's a question of definition. What is difference in accelerated universe? Take now t in power alpha, but alpha larger than 1. From where will come the main contribution in the integral? From low bound. Therefore, this thing will, at large t, will approach some constant. But in this case, scale factor will be growing, and in the accelerated universe, the size of particle horizon is proportional to the scale factor. Therefore, here, okay, comes an exponent, as you understand. If you will take here exponential functions, then you will find that, like for the sitter, that the size of causally connected region is growing exponentially fast. Again, some people say that it's superluminal expansion, but of course it's squatch. It's not superluminal expansion, just the space is stretching faster than so-called the speed of light in some sense. But on the other side, if you measure speed locally, then it's always speed of light, okay? Therefore, there is nothing wrong about causality, etc. So don't trust to everything what New York Times writes. So, I mean physics, okay, politics, I don't care. So, now, let's go to the other notion, because you understand in this particular case that in decelerated universe you have unusual situation. During very short time you can make very huge causally connected region. This is, by the way, one of the meaning of solution of causality problem or whatsoever, I don't know. Now, the other notion is related with the fact that universe has finite lifetime in terms of conformal time. And this is the notion of so-called particle horizon, not particle event horizon. You see, now, what does it mean event horizon? At the given moment of time t. It means that everything what happened at this moment of time, okay, beyond this event horizon, we will never see in the future. So all this event which happened outside event horizon cannot influence our future because of the causality. And it's related with the fact, as I tell, that there is eta maximum in conformal time. So now, how to define event horizon? Again, the same thing, okay? This d event as a function of high, it's equal eta maximum minus eta. This is maximal distance which light can travel to us, and everything what is larger than this commoving distance, okay, all events which are happening there at the moment of time eta will never reach us. Again, how can we rewrite this thing in terms of physical scales? So dE is equal A, again taken at the moment of time t, integral from t, present time, to t maximal. dt over AT. Before I will go to this formula, let me draw this event horizon here. Okay, so in the universe pressure equal to zero. At the moment of maximal expansion, particle horizon stop to exist, but event horizon reappears. And it goes like this one. It's clear that all events which happened here can never be seen by observer because it will be first killed in the singularity. Now, therefore, here, in this case, there exists one event and after that particle and after that event horizon. In the case of de Sitter, and in the case of p equal epsilon over 3, event horizon is like this one. It always exists in this universe. In the universe, which is filled by radiation, event horizon is related with the fact that I will be killed in the singularity. In the case of de Sitter, it's related with the fact that exponential expansion will be throwing light from me much faster than light will approach me. You know, the sitter in this sense is like black hole inversion. The best image for the black hole, you know, this waterfall. You see? And imagine that you are on the boat here. And your maximal speed is V max. And horizon for the waterfall is defined by the relation that your maximal speed which you can develop on the boat is equal to the speed of waterfall at this point. If you are a little bit here, sorry about you. Yeah, if you are a little bit here, then you still have chance to escape. What is the sitter? It's reversed waterfall. You see, so if it's reversed, you will never be able to come inside. You see, this is precisely the meaning of this event horizon. Now, let's look, what does it mean, this thing, from this point of view. In decelerating universe, okay, if, for instance, it's infinite, particle event horizon, sorry, event horizon doesn't exist. But let's take A proportional to T in power alpha, where alpha is larger than 1. Then you understand that this integral is converging even if T maximal is equal to infinity. So in the case of decelerating universe, finite conformal time can correspond to the infinite physical time. And in fact, in this particular case, if we will take for the scale factor exponent ht, yeah, then you will get that event horizon is equal h lambda minus 1. It's constant for this particular case. So this means, what does it mean? This kind of thing, yeah? So it's constant radius or constant sphere which surrounds us. And if you will take light quanta, which here is going to us, then this quanta is moving with the speed of light, but space returns this back, and therefore quanta always stays on this horizon. And this is, by the way, the explanation why horizon here is time-like hypersurface. You see, because quanta which try to approach us always stay at the same place, but it doesn't mean that life or quanta is at rest, of course. If they would be at rest, they would age. As I tell, okay, light is a dream of the girls because they never age. But on the other side, no feeling also. So, okay, so this is the notion of event horizon. It's quite important when we are trying to explain how universe originated. Because now, imagine that we produce some accelerated region. Of course, it's hard to produce this region to be homogeneous everywhere. But for us, it's enough to produce it homogeneous just within the scale, which is couple of times larger than event horizon. Here you can have, after that, whatever you want, it will not influence this region anyway. And this region will be blown up and grows proportional to the size of particle horizon, or grows up exponentially. So from one little region, after that, you are getting huge universe. Okay, and as I will tell later, you start with zero number degrees of freedom, and you are producing infinite number degrees of freedom using good infinity, which are called ultraviolet infinity, yeah? Don't mix it with bad infrared infinities. Okay, good. So, I mean very simple thing. You see, nobody knows what happens, of course, inside Planck scales. You start with universe which is Planck size. Energy density is a Planck energy. Then you are getting huge universe. Of course, in decelerator you could say, how can you say so if everything is time translation invariant? But you shouldn't forget Kabbalah, which tells that divine configuration can be perfected only by breaking them. And now I recall, at the beginning, I couldn't understand this kind of things which Zeldovich was telling, that the sitter is useful only when time translation invariance is slightly broken. When it's slightly broken, you have the invariant notion, what does it mean that the size of your universe has grown. And then, you see, because gravity is infinite reservoir for the energy, you can take and convert some energy of the gravitational field to the matter. This is what I meant when I told that I start with nothing and then produce universe with 1080 degrees of freedom, which we have today, by the way. Okay, good. Now, next notion is the notion of redshift. And after that, two more remarks about standard candles, and then I will go to extremely boring thing. The only justification for that is reality, to atomic physics and to nuclear physics. But for completeness, of course, I will tell about it and will try to do it in the most entertaining possible style. But, okay, I do not know how much I succeed. But now, what happens with quanta which we have in the expanding universe? Well, you know that the wavelength of the quanta is growing proportional to the scale factor. How to see it, to prove it exactly, is very simple thing again. Assume that you have here some emitter at high emission. Here is observer. Then light which this guy is emitting always goes under 45 degrees at the next moment of time. Again 45 degrees, so delta eta at the point of receiving. Here eta, yeah. Yet delta eta conformal time is not changing at the point of emission, etc. But physical time is of course ds, and ds or delta tau is equal a t delta tau, delta eta. Therefore, it's clear that the ratio of the physical wavelengths at the moment of emission and at the moment of this reception of these quants are different by the scale factor at the appropriate moment of time. So you are getting that lambda for the quanta at the moment of observation to lambda at the moment of emission is the ratio t at the moment of observation. You can safely put here t0 to the moment of emission. You see? And the wavelength is growing proportionally to the size of the universe. In cosmology, people are introducing so-called redshift parameter, which is equal to the difference of this thing, emission over lambda emission, yeah, and this thing again can be written down as the ratio of the scale factor at present to the scale factor in past at emission minus one. Now, also you understand that this redshift parameter you can use to characterize the moment of time in the past, in the universe, because you can resolve this equation and express t in terms of z. Therefore, z can be used also as a time in the past. And it tells, okay, that in past, when redshift was z, universe had the size z plus one times small. You see, because everything what we see today at large redshifts, galaxies emitted, for instance, at redshift 7, 8, galaxies emitted, or objects, better to say, yeah, when universe was 9 times smaller, so we see past of our universe. Also, because there is this relation for the photon geodesic, redshift can be used as a measure of distance, but only within the scales from which light can reach us. So you can write high coordinate in the universe as a function of redshift, but if redshift is going to infinity, what will be the distance, to where distance which corresponds to this redshift will go? Of course, to horizon, you see, because we cannot see anything beyond horizon. Time could be used everywhere, but redshift only within observable region. And now let me mention two things which actually were crucial during this experimental development, the experimental finding during last 10 years. Namely, standard candles and standard ruler. Standard candles are the object in astrophysics about which astrophysicists think that they have the same luminosity. You see, but you know that some objects do not need to follow to what astrophysicists think about them. And this kind of effect, when objects do not agree with astrophysicists, is called systematics. Yeah, now, standard ruler is the object about which we think that we know its size. And in fact, there is only for standard candles, what we use the supernova 1A, which are standard enough, yeah. And standard ruler, the only good standard ruler which we know, and with the help of which we can measure geometry, is the size of the horizon at the moment of so-called recombination when universe became transparent. And we used acceleration, standard candle, to discover dark energy, and standard rulers we used to find out the curvature of the universe. Because how we could determine the curvature of the universe? Of course, one of the ways, you measure Hubble constant, and then measure all components of the universe, add all of them, and compare. But for that, you have to have very good really eyes, because you should be able to see what is invisible. The other things, how can you discover the things which you cannot see? Via gravity, because everything contributes to the gravity. Gravity is universal. And gravity in terms, okay, defines or determines the curvature of the space. So the other way to measure, for instance, the curvature or total rho is to measure geometry of the universe using standard ruler, and this standard ruler is so-called first Doppler peak in CMB observations. So now let me say two words what is going on. What is standard candle, as I explained, yeah? And you do the following thing. You have some object with a total luminosity L at some distance from us, and we are here now. I changed coordinate system and I put myself not in the center, but I put center in the supernova, yeah? And I am at the distance I am, emission, distance to supernova. Then, if you have luminosity L, then during conformal time, during time interval delta T, the amount of emitted energy by this supernova in all directions isotropically will be luminosity multiplied by physical time, which is nothing more than A at the moment of emission multiplied by delta eta. Then these quanta are propagating to me and they are filling some shell. Of course, during the time when they were propagating, all of them were redshifted. Therefore, when the quanta are coming to the shell, all of them, at the moment of detection, has energy, which is changed by the ratio of A emission to A zero, scale factor at present. Now you are interested in flux of this radiation, which I see. Okay, assuming that it's isotropic. What is this flux? F is equal delta E at the moment of detection divided by the radius or by the surface of this shell, which is 4 pi A0 squared, and multiplied in flat space, it would be chi squared. But in curved space, it's this function f, which I wrote, squared, which depends on chi emission, which is sine, sine hyperbolic, or just chi. And, of course, divided by delta t observation, and delta t at the moment of observation is a zero delta eta. Delta eta is the same as here. Now, substitute this thing here, and you get some kind of long, ugly formula. But it's useful to have for this formula some approximation, at least at small redshift, at redshift smaller than 0.3, in spite of the fact that supernova observed at z equal 1, but okay, there you have to use this long expression. But to get feeling what all this about, let me write approximation for z smaller than 0.3. Okay, so astronomers introduce so-called bolometric magnitude. I do not know what is this, doesn't matter. Don't ask why it's defined like this one. And here logarithm for 10, yeah, f is all whole field, separate field, okay, with all these bloody names. But, okay, they define this quantity. Now, it's flux, but you understand that if flux is large, then magnitude is more negative. So it's a little bit reversed what I would define as a physicist, but you know that astronomers, they have their own way of thinking. Therefore, it's nothing bad, by the way. Just separate other way of thinking. And now, if I will take this formula, substitute it here, then I will get the following approximation. 5 log 10 z, z redshift. Now, minus 2.5 divided by natural logarithm 10, okay, sorry, 1 minus q0, z plus the term which are quadratic in z. What is q0? It's so-called deceleration parameter, which can be expressed like 1/2 omega 0, and most important, 1 plus 3 p over epsilon. Therefore, you understand that measuring this curve, you can get idea about this term. And if you have accelerated universe, then this term, of course, is positive. Okay, no, negative. And in such a way, you can see the presence of dark energy. So, what people have seen? Okay, they were observing this m-bolometric from different supernova as a function of redshift. You can make, based on this exact formula, the following prediction, fixing total omega, for instance, for omega m equals 0, omega cosmological constant lambda equal 1, the other curve would be for omega m equals 0.3 omega lambda. Now I fixed total omega, yeah, so omega lambda, omega m 0.3 omega lambda is 0.7, and here omega m is 1, omega lambda is 0, would be the third curve. So observing supernova in the range of redshift between 1 and 1.5, people discovered the point which was scattered more around this middle thing. Despite all the ways that I can tell you, okay, I looked all these papers. Half a year before declaring about cosmological constants, there was a paper by the same group where they were positively claiming that they proved using this supernova that omega lambda is equal to 0. In half a year, they changed their mind. They had, of course, more data, but you understand that in principle, you could think that the things could be weakened here by the dust on our way, because dust is headache not only for CMB. For CMB, it recently became a lot of headache, but for supernova, it was always headache. And I had, by the way, bet with Vilenkin, where I told him that your cosmological constant will decay in half a year. For a bottle of good wine, by the way. But I would never buy him this bottle if it would be only supernova. In fact, actually, the real proof for the existence of this thing came after Boomerang discovered second Doppler peak. You see, because second Doppler peak without cosmological constant, no way to explain. Because, you know what is the reason? Because if you have baryons, they try to kill this guy. And in this particular case, cold matter also tried to kill it. And to preserve it, there is only one way, okay? To put some amount of cold matter in something what doesn't influence, what doesn't kill this second Doppler peak. You see, keeping omega total equal 1. After that, of course, I bought wine. But Vilenkin interpreted it wrongly he told that I bought it because I wanted to drink it myself. But I bought it because I'm honest guy sometimes. So now, second thing is so-called standard rulers, which allowed us to measure curvature. Because as I said, light decoupled from the rest of the matter when temperature was 3,000 degrees and when universe was about 300,000 years old. At this time, there is a natural scale, which is the scale of horizon, or better to say, the scale of sound horizon, because at this time, perturbations are standing sound waves. And sound, of course, has speed of propagation, which is not very different from speed of light, but nevertheless, okay, it has characteristic features in the spectra produced at this moment of time, which we can observe today. And this corresponds to T, so-called recombination, which is about 300,000 light years. So it's the scale of the order of the scale of galaxy. And you could ask question, under which angle you would observe this scale today? D, yeah? So this thing is CT recombination. And then you calculate this angle theta, assuming that the universe, for instance, is like Minkowski space. Then what would be the angle in this case? This thing is CT0. And it's clear that in flat space, okay, the angle would be T recombination to T0 at present, or in terms of redshift, it corresponds to redshift 100, okay, it would be Z recombination in power minus 3/2. It would be around 1,000 times smaller than 1 degree. But in curved space, things happen differently. And this angle is much larger, 1,000 times larger. And this is the effect of the curvature of space-time, which you will see in a minute, yeah? How can I write this distance? If I know metric, then, okay, you write ds squared is equal dt squared minus a squared, which depends on t, here d high squared, squared plus phi squared, which depends on high and curvature, and here d theta squared plus d phi squared. Now, what is this distance? It's interval between two events, when two quanta were emitted, and I have seen them today as angle separation delta theta. Therefore, I can write this thing. So they were emitted at the same moment of time, this term is out. They had the same position, high emission. This term is out. And the only term which stands here is phi, high emission, delta theta. Phi is the same. Therefore, I can write this D, standard ruler, as minus D squared, because I use Russian convention, as Tibo told, for signature. I don't know, by the way, why Russian. American is the same. No? Depends on the American, by the way. So, Bob Wold, plus, minus, 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 or minus, plus? Everybody, yeah. But Landau Lifshitz used this for me is also okay, yeah. So now here you write minus a squared taken at the moment of emission, and then phi at the moment high emission, delta theta. And then this delta theta squared and here squared, yeah. Minus, minus give you plus. All the squares goes away. Okay, and then you are getting that delta theta is equal to this D, which is CP recombination, divided by A at T emission, phi at the point of emission. Now, if object is close to us, then this AT emission is more or less the same as A0, yeah? Then, all the functions, sine hyperbolic, normal sine, and linear function for small distances are the same, they are high emission. A multiplied by high emission is distance to the object in the vicinity of us, and then you are getting that this angle in the vicinity of us is just d divided to the distance to this object. But let's consider this ruler in faraway past, when the scale factor was 1,000 times smaller than it's right now. And then you understand that when redshift z becomes of the order of 1, then for the given d, instead of decreasing, angular scale of the object starts to increase. You see? Because of this factor. And it starts to increase proportionally to redshift. Because you can write here a0, then when z is very large, then this thing goes to constant. And for large z, delta theta is proportional to redshift. Now, redshift, which corresponds to this standard ruler, is 1,000. And it growed instead of decreasing. Therefore, instead of having here z in power minus, this was Euclidean result. It was z in power recombination in power minus 3/2. Now, because you have extra factor because of curvature of space-time, this 3/2 becomes minus 1/2. You see, when you see this thing, it's direct proof of general relativity also. And of course, the best analog how to understand this thing, which is, by the way, wrong analog, but I can tell you, consider the surface of the Earth and start to move your object from here to here. It's clear that the minimal size, it will get angular size when it's on equator. But when you start to move it further, then the angular size will start to grow. And in fact, if you will move object to the from North Pole to the South Pole, it will overshadow your sky. In principle, okay, all the galaxies, if you would move them to the horizon, they would overshadow your sky. But of course, brightness would be negligible. It's a different story. And moreover, if you would consider now this function f, because it also should come in delta theta, you could express in the universe without cosmological constant this angle in terms of omega. Yeah? And in dust-dominated universe without cosmological constant, delta theta would be equal z recombination minus 1/2 multiplied by square root of omega 0. Where omega 0, you would think the total contribution to the, of the cold matter in the universe. So, this angle you could write as 0.87 degrees square root of omega 0. When you have cosmological constant, formulas look more ugly, but essence is the same. Now, if you know size, if you know delta theta, it's clearly you can determine omega zero. Without knowing what are the other components in the universe, and in fact, location of first Doppler peak, of course, the things are not as simple as I say, but nevertheless, the essence is more or less the same. Is precisely this standard ruler with the help of which I measure the geometry of our universe, and I find from this precision data right now that omega is equal 1 with accuracy better than 0.5%. And I think in new release it will be even a little bit better. Okay, so this is the other thing, by the way, which came first time. I have to tell who established the flatness of the universe. It was not Boomerang, it was not Maxima. It actually, everybody speaks about Boomerang and Maxima because Lyman Page is too modest guy, yeah, in spite of the fact that he's in Princeton. he doesn't like to speak about himself. But in fact, actually, first time flatness of the universe was established half a year before Boomerang and Planck in two experiments called TACO, okay, which is some mountain in Chile, and Saskatoon, maybe you know, very cold place in Canada. Okay, so two ground-based experiments, one measured point on the left side and the other on the right side of what is called first Doppler peak, and it found it in the right place. After, okay, this thing was found, there was no doubt anymore that, well, at least for some people, that universe is flat. After second Doppler peak was found, all the people who were doing cosmic strings, textures, gave up. So, by the way, in this sense, cosmic string and textures were physical theories because they were ruled out. Yeah? In this sense, they are better than some theories which cannot be ruled out. Okay. Now, okay, I still have 20 minutes, and these 20 minutes I will spend for this 13.7 billion years. I will tell you brief thermal history of time, and 20 minutes is enough. I just will shorten certain things because I want to finish this stuff and go to more sexy things like these quantum fluctuations next time. But quantum fluctuations tomorrow, right? After. And tomorrow we start at 9:30. Yes. Sure. Yeah, good. Okay, now. So, first of all, because temperature is growing proportionally to wavelengths, is proportional to the scale factor, it's clear that temperature, which is inversely proportional to the typical wavelengths, should be proportional to 1 over scale factor. And if today it's equal to 2.7, then at the moment when the universe was 1,000 times smaller, this temperature was 2,700 degrees. It's more or less clear. This is what I call era of time. Now, okay, let's start here and let's travel to the past. So today it's 13.7 billion light years, or 10^17 seconds. Then let's go in past a little bit. And let's say what was happening in past. No, it's clear that here 2.7 degrees of Kelvin, people, galaxies, but it's more or less boring physics, okay? And it's very boring, related with this large-scale structure formation, etc., etc., until we will come to the moment of time which correspond to about 300,000 light years, or 10^12, 10^13 seconds, or temperature at this moment was about 3,000 degrees. Here life becomes a little bit more interesting. Why? Because here atomic physics comes in the play. Why? Because at the temperature 3,000 degrees, what happens? Hydrogen or proton capture remaining electron in our universe and they form neutral hydrogen, and become neutral hydrogen is 4,000 times less efficient in the scattering 3,000. In the scattering of the radiation, because you have to move electrons there together with the proton, which is too heavy a little bit. As a result, all the photons which were scattered here by free electrons, which have cross-section 10^24 centimeters squared, okay, all the photons become liberated, and they start to propagate to us without further scattering, delivering us the picture of the universe which we had at this moment of time. So CMB allows us to have direct photograph of the universe which was just 300,000-400,000 years old. Why I say 300,000-400,000 years old? Because this process of the liberation of the photons is not instantaneous. It goes about 1/3, 1/4 of the cosmological time here. So the whole duration of this process is about 90,000 years. And concentration of free electron drops down gradually. So universe becomes transparent gradually. And this thing is extremely important, because if recombination would be instantaneous, we would never see any polarization in CMB. But because universe becomes a little bit transparent, it allows to the radiation to form quadrupole anisotropy for me, if I am electron which is supposed to scatter the quanta last time. And as a result of scattering on me, okay, of the radiation which has quadrupole anisotropy, radiation which was not polarized at the beginning gets polarized. And it gets polarized within this middle of the layer of recombination. And of course, all these processes are well studied, very exactly calculated. And the most amazing thing, that the dominating role in the process of making universe transparent is played by some process which never play any role in any other natural conditions. You see, what is this process? How would you think photons or hydrogen becomes neutral? Okay, you have reservoir which consists here electron and proton. Then you could think that there is direct recombination. You form neutral hydrogen at one less level. But you understand that photons, which are emitted, are very energetic, and they ionize the things immediately. Therefore, all these processes of direct recombination of hydrogen on the ground state are inefficient. The other thing which is more efficient is so-called cascade recombination. But cascade recombination normally goes through 2p level, okay, 2p level of the hydrogen atom. And as a result of this transition, they emitted always quanta, which is called Lyman alpha quanta. And this Lyman alpha quanta is a resonance quanta, which has absorption cross-section at this time, which is 10^8 times larger than the cross-section of the scattering on the electron. Therefore, when it's immediately reabsorbed. This process, and then when you bring atom up, then you can ionize it first. And what Sunyaev and Zeldovich and later people, and Kurt and later people noticed, that in this condition, the main role in making decreasing the ionization degree is played by 2 quanta decay of 2s hydrogen atom. It cannot go here with emission of 1 quanta because of the conservation of moment. Okay, process of 2 quanta emission is 100 billion times less probable than this transition. But nevertheless, this actually process determines degree of ionization with, I think it's 8.1, as far as I remember, second minus 1, during most of the time. And this ionization decrease during these 90,000 years is a gradual process, okay, which is far away from equilibrium. Because if you apply Saha formula, you will get mistake orders of magnitude. You see? No, but okay, of course, conservation of momentum, because 2s, 1s, 0, angular momentum, angle, yeah, angle, of course. Yeah, now, then, of course, this process determines you degree of ionization, and this degree of ionization, how it depends on time, forms the pattern of these polarization curves, which people observe right now in Planck with unbelievable accuracy. Question to auditorium. Is the following. Okay, this thing can be calculated theoretically very good. Now, how good this thing can be measured in the lab? Two quanta decay of 2s hydrogen atom. How good? What is the accuracy of the measuring this thing? Because, of course, you can say, why should you measure if you know it theoretically, but it's okay. Different story, okay, for different people. No way to get any accuracy. I talked to Hensch, who actually is the best specialist in this thing because he got his Nobel Prize for this 2S. He knows that, okay, to measure it with reasonable accuracy, I have to have device, okay, this at least 10 times larger. Now, you can keep this thing in cosmology as a free parameter, and you can ask, how accurately you can measure this parameter from cosmological observation of TT and EE correlation function? Recent result, which are still preliminary unpublished, but they did already this exercise, 5%. So you see here, cosmology became better than particle physics at any cost. Atomic physics, not particle physics, it still will become when we go in past. Sorry. So, and you see, okay, we wrote this paper with Nasevsky 1 year ago, nobody paid attention, but now when people see it in observation, okay, I think it was one of the hot topics discussed in Ferrara, that now they can compete with atomic physics. Now, let's go then in past. First in past, I still have 5 minutes. And because now it's less than 300,000 years, I think 5 minutes will be okay. Now, then there is next moment of time when universe was 5 times smaller or 10 times smaller than this one. And then there is a moment which is called equality when thermal radiation, okay, had the same energy density as cold dark matter plus baryons. Here, first 3 Doppler peaks are formed, which we will see in observations, precisely in this region. And dynamic here is quite important because from initial adiabatic perturbations, of course, effectively, they are formed here also entropic component because cold matter particles can move free. Moreover, if you want to get from observation here and observation here consistency, you have to assume that gravitational stability started a little bit earlier. So it means that cold dark matter cannot be normal baryonic matter because normal baryonic matter, which is ionized, cannot move with respect to the radiation. And radiation pressure prevents gravitational stability. This is extra proof that cold dark matter has non-baryonic origin. You see? Now let's go first. What is the next interesting moment of time? The next interesting moment of time, and here, by the way, instead of that, we can use also temperature. And instead of time, we can also use temperature. How to get relation between temperature and time? You know that before radiation was dominated, order of magnitude energy density was T4. Energy density. Energy density is equal to Hubble constant squared, and Hubble constant squared is 1 over T. Squared. From here you have relation in Planck units that T is equal 1 over square root of time. If you want to go from Planck units to the normal unit, you substitute here time in terms of 10 minus 44 seconds, temperature in terms of 1019 GV. And then you get nice formula, second 1 MeV. You see, so when time was 1 second, temperature up to the coefficient of the order of 1 was 1 MeV. You go in past, and then you meet here the moment of time which Steve Weinberg called 3 minutes. And it's 3 minutes between 3 and 5 minutes. Why these 3 minutes are so good? Because when temperature is 0.05 MeV, nuclear reaction happens. You could ask me, why not before? Because if you will take binding energy for deuterium, then it's 2.3 MeV. If you take binding energy for helium-4, it's 27 MeV. For tritium and helium, it's 7. Because what Steve actually discovered of so-called deuterium bottleneck. What is this? How you form helium? Helium consists of two protons and neutrons. For the people who forget what is this, okay, working with brains. But you see, for four guys to meet simultaneously in one place, very low probability. Because of that, how nuclear reactions are happening? You have a reservoir of protons and neutrons. Then they come together and dissociated, and they form deuterium. Deuterium have very low binding energy, 2.3 MeV. And if you will take it, okay, at the temperatures which were higher than 0.05 MeV, deuterium abundance, equilibrium abundance was 10 minus 10 or whatsoever. You can forget about it, yeah? Because there is also big factor, like number of photons per one deuterium nuclei per one proton. Now, only when temperature dropped to this value, 0.05, deuterium abundance grew to 10 minus 2 first. Finally, it was decreasing to 10 minus 4. Because it's exponential dependence. And what was called deuterium bottleneck, okay, was opened. And after that, what happened? Deuterium started to interact with deuterium, or deuterium plus proton. That's a possibility, and it was forming helium-3. Or there is also was possibility deuterium to form tritium. This is 7 MeV, this is 7 MeV. Then helium could interact with deuterium and then bind helium-4. Tritium also could interact with deuterium, also go here. Here binding energy is 28 MeV. Then you know the main principle of equilibrium. If somebody is stronger, then he becomes dominant, yeah? So helium in this case is dominant guy because it has the highest binding energy. And all protons and neutrons should end up here. But of course, finally the whole process will stop. There is so-called freeze out, and these tubes in the reservoir will be broken. And there will be a little bit things which will be left here. Therefore, most of free neutrons form with protons, all, practically all free neutrons, helium-4. But there is a little bit left for deuterium at the level of 10 minus 4, okay, compared to 1. And also something is left for helium-3, which is more difficult to observe, and for tritium, but tritium is decaying 13 years, yeah? This is the reason when yesterday we were discussing, I told Ginzburg's great contribution to H-bomb was that Ginzburg suggested to use instead of tritium the lithium. I am finishing, yeah. So, because otherwise you would need to change weapon each 5 years. And here, I'm finishing with this thing, and further excursion for first few seconds will require a little bit more than 5 minutes, therefore I will start with it tomorrow. But of course, the precise amount of deuterium and precise amount of helium, which will be formed, depends on the concentration of baryons in our universe, or better to say, about number of photons per one baryon, which is characterized by this parameter eta, which is 10^10 multiplied n nucleon over n gamma. And okay, for what we have today, this thing is expected between 1 and 10. Okay, 5 correspond to 4% of the total contribution of baryons. Now, the abundance of helium-4 depends only logarithmically on this eta. It also depends on the number of ultra-relativistic particles. This is, by the way, why people were making extra claim, two-series claim, that they could put bounds that the number of neutrinos should be smaller than 1.7. You see, there was this thing, now all this kind of stuff is gone. But you know that here the amount of helium will be determined by the amount of neutron which survived at the moment of this thing. The amount of neutron is determined by freeze-out concentration of neutron when chemical equilibrium between proton and neutron is out. All this weak interaction reaction, which are keeping this kind of equilibrium, are gone, and it happens at the moment 1 second after Big Bang. And at this moment of time, the amount of neutrons is 32%, 16%. If all of them would form helium, then we would have 32% of helium. But then, after 1 minute, you have to wait still 200 seconds. And neutron, as you know, is unstable, and it leaves 800 or 900 seconds. Then quarter of this amount decays. Then you stay with 12% of neutrons, which didn't decay, and they form 24% of helium, which should be there. You see, and then you observe today this. But what is more exciting, that amount of deuterium which is left, because here dependence on eta is logarithmic. For deuterium, first it goes down inversely proportional to eta, and then at a certain point it starts to go down like exponent minus eta. What is the difference? Why it happens? Because at this time, the main reactions which are responsible for destroying of deuterium are deuterium-deuterium reaction, here and here. But for smaller concentration, for larger concentration of nucleons, this reaction, deuterium plus proton, starts to dominate. So you understand that instead of equation which is non-linear, you are getting linear equation with exponential solution. And what we are measuring today, for instance, in supernova, not in supernova, but in far remote clouds, point precisely here. And we can determine from this nucleosynthesis, irrespectively from any CMB, what is the concentration of baryons. And then we are getting it with extremely high accuracy. And the most striking thing, that this number is precisely the same what people are getting from measuring features of the CMB spectra, which have nothing to do with this nucleosynthesis. Therefore, when people say that, okay, I have 6-parameter curve, okay, to fit, it's all quatsch, okay? You have 1-parameter curve because you have to use this thing, you have to use supernova, you have to use Hubble telescope to fix the other parameters. Otherwise, for instance, I don't understand why these guys from supernova got Nobel Prize, yeah? If you don't use them, they went for this thing. And then after you fix all these parameters from here, you have 1-parameter curve for CMB to fit all this data. 3 curves. This is what is striking. Okay, so I think this is a good point to finish.
Квадратное должно быть.